Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our webinar in palliative care in general practice, how to better support your patients. My name is Gloria. I'm the palliative care project officer at Central and Eastern Sydney Primary Health Network. I'd like to start by acknowledging the traditional custodians and sovereign people of the land across which we work. We recognize their continuing connection to land, water, and community, and pay respects to elders past, present and emerging. We also extend that respect to any Aboriginal colleagues who may be joining us this evening. I just wanted to quickly touch on the Care Finder program, which is a new program that Central Eastern Sydney PHN is rolling out. There will be industry briefings on the 27th of July and the 3rd of August if you're interested in finding out more about this new aged care program. I'd like to introduce our first speaker for tonight. It's Dr. Megan Ritchie. Dr. Ritchie is a palliative care specialist at Concord Hospital and the clinical lead for the Sydney Local Health District Western Zone. Dr. Ritchie's primary interests include community-based care and research, particularly in the areas of cancer-related fatigue and anorexia.
Hi everyone, I'm Megan. Thanks so much for inviting me to come to speak tonight. And thanks for the introduction, Gloria. So I really welcome any questions or interaction throughout. Please stop me. Really, you know, would be very happy for this to be as interactive as possible. I'm going to start with looking at some of the changing models of care in palliative medicine. And then I'll be talking about ways to refer, points to refer, who to refer, and the Sydney Local Health District. And then Dr. Linda Sheehan will be talking about some more of the specifics of palliative care, as well as the southeastern zone referrals as well. So if it's all right, I might talk about, with the next slide, Gloria, the traditional model. So palliative care is actually a relatively new specialty, if you think about all the different areas of internal medicine. And traditionally, I think it started more where treatments would continue up to the point where no further active treatments could be given, such as chemotherapy or dialysis or other active treatment models. And then palliative care would be called in for the end of life transition in really what is a very brief period before end of life. And this, we've been seeing a shift in how palliative care has evolved as a model of care, particularly in the last two decades. And if we go to the next slide here, I've just listed some areas of research that highlight this. Probably the best well-known is the Tamel trial in the New England Journal of Medicine in 2010 from the MGH group, and it's the most well-known. It looked at 151 patients with metastatic non-small cell lung cancer, which were randomized to two arms, one with usual palliative care referral when deemed appropriate by the treating clinician team. And the other was early palliative care involvement, where all patients in that arm had a routine referral at 6 weeks with regular review until death. And the primary endpoint was quality of life as well as mood. And while they found significant improvements in both of these arms, somewhat surprisingly, the trial showed an overall survival benefit of 3 months in the palliative care arm. And so it was certainly seen not to be a harmful thing to refer earlier on than traditionally thought for palliative care. They also found in secondary analysis that there was less intravenous chemotherapy given in the last 2 months of life in the palliative care arm, no difference in the oral chemotherapy arm, but also a greater uptake of palliative care units or hospice use at the end of life. The second trial, Zimmerman in the Lancet, this was opened up to a much larger cancer population group, and it found significant improvements in quality of life and satisfaction in overall care and well-being, and no difference in survival. And that was somewhat replicated in the third trial listed as well. And there are lots of other trials. In fact, one's just been completed here across multiple sites across Sydney the Pearl study, which in a way is trying to replicate the Tamil study, but the results are still not out. But lots of evidence has been showing a shift and change towards earlier involvement in palliative care. And so if we go to the next slide, we'll see that there is a changing shift towards integrative palliative care. And now the American Society of Clinical Oncology recommends combining standard oncology and palliative care earlier in the course of the disease for all patients with metastatic cancer. There are, of course, barriers to this, particularly along resources, the availability of services. We see, we are pretty lucky in Sydney overall, but in rural areas, there's certainly a lack of resources. A lot of people are not aware that this is a shift that is happening, and a lot of people are really worried on their first appointment. The perception that palliative care equates with immediate end of life, and they often come up, some bemused into the clinic rooms, I thought everything was going okay, and it requires a bit of explanation that actually this is more of an integrative and supportive role at this point in time. And so, yes, there's certainly ongoing barriers to this and lots of explanations that occur. And absolutely, involving palliative care does not mean giving up disease-directed therapies. And so we're seeing now more a shift towards newer models of care in the next slide, where what we call Dr. Philippa Hawley in Canada coined the bow tie model, where it's evolving, where palliative care is now described as an approach, or can be described as an approach to applying a care to life-threatening illnesses that is applicable early in the course of illness in conjunction with other therapies that are intended to prolong life. And it also gives the option for discharge. If you look in, I'm not sure you won't be able to see my mouse, but in the top model, there is survivorship and there is the option for discharge from clinics. And I see that particularly with some of the hematological malignancies or some of the newer immunotherapies that are coming out with solid organ cancers, that people can have really dreadful symptoms due to where their disease is, but some treatments can melt away. And so you can end up with some intensive periods of symptom management, but then as treatment progresses or helps, you're able to discharge or hand off or prolong your follow-ups with patients. And so we see much more integrated and flow approach with earlier referrals, where we get to know the patients for longer courses of their illness. And so I think if we can really just recognize that later referrals limit the ability to achieve maximum potential for the relief of suffering and also the medical care cost containment that can sometimes go with that as well. And so I think the shift, I know there's shifts with where should we be still named palliative care or supportive care, but I think we just don't want the association that palliative care necessarily means that the person is imminently dying. If we can just go to the next slide. And Dr. Sheehan will talk a bit more about this, but there's certainly the benefits of palliative care with early referral and throughout disease trajectory is that you see reduction in symptom burden. And this is addressed, and if when pain is more severe, you'll see that there's an increase in analgesia. And when things are better, you see a weaning. And it's actually a lot of the weaning and deprescribing takes a lot of effort too as part of this. You see improvements in quality of life, improvements of mood with reduction of depression, increased patient and caregiver satisfaction. It may increase survival, although I think it's a little controversial to say that definitively, and there's decreased burnout among other providers. If we can go to the next slide. And so at the moment, who should be referred? Well, the National Comprehensive Cancer Network says that anyone really with severe, serious, or life-limiting illness with uncontrolled symptoms, be it malignant or non-malignant, moderate or severe distress related to either diagnosis or the treatment. And we certainly get a lot of referrals for people with side effects of their treatments that are very problematic, whether it be gastrointestinal, nausea, pain, neuropathies, that sort of thing. Serious comorbid physical and psychosocial conditions. And we'll talk about that a bit later, but we don't work mostly as individual practitioners. We come with a team of allied health, clinical psychologists and social workers who are really important to help address some of the psychosocial conditions of the people that we see. Those with life expectancies of less than 6 months, family or patient concerns about the disease course or treatment options, and certainly any patient or family that requests a palliative care consultation. And we'll go to the next slide. And I really like the surprise question. And so the surprise question is, would you be surprised if that person were to die within 1 year? It does actually carry some weight. What we refer to, I think, as the gut intuition of the trajectory of our patient. And there was actually a study that was done in the Dana-Farber Cancer Center in Boston. And it looked at 70 oncology clinicians, about three quarters were physicians. And they had a patient cohort group of nearly 4,800 patients. And they asked them, would you be surprised if the patient were to die in a year? And they got them to look over the files of these patients. And no, so 700 patients were thought it would be they would think that it's most likely that they were to die within the year. And they followed these patients up. And the sensitivity was only, it was found that this actually had a pretty good sensitivity as a screening tool. And while it can't be taken, it needs to be taken in as a multimodal assessment as to who will benefit from palliative care, but your gut intuition does actually carry a lot of weight and can be incorporated into clinical practice. So if we go to the next slide, other pointers of when to refer. Certainly anyone with a diagnosis of metastatic cancer can be referred. If on review the thought is that it's too early, then absolutely the worst that will happen is a delayed follow-up. We get a lot of referrals, particularly from oncologists at what we coin critical clinical decision points. For instance, at the time of disease progression on scans, if there are new complications of the cancer, particularly with physical symptoms, obstructions, bleeding, that sort of thing, any messy side effects of treatment, and also then at sentinel events and abrupt deterioration, such as with ED visitations or hospital admissions. We get a lot of hospital consultations with those reviews. And we also get referrals with patients who might be struggling with decision making. Should they have that third line of chemotherapy? They might be indecisive, they might need to spend some more time to think about it. And it's not a second opinion, but just have, a chance to talk through what the options either way may look like. If we can go to the next slide. And so if we're looking at integrated care, outpatient palliative care is semi-structured, but it's a really flexible approach. And we find that in terms of optimal timing of discussions, patients who referred earlier, you get a lot of chance to build rapport and you get chances to discuss prognosis values earlier on, and they can change into and morph into more end-of-life care-based discussions as disease progresses. We find that as we get to know patients better, you spend more time talking about values and it's easier to make advanced care planning decisions. With the patients, it's all less raw and abrupt when sudden changes happen. And they do, it happens all the time over weekends when there's skeleton staff on and you're not able to have really in-depth discussions. So being able to talk about values documented in very clear places, it makes the sentinel events of the sudden deterioration out of hours, It gives very clear instructions to staff who might be working after hours, such as the ED physicians. But it also means that you've discussed this most importantly with family members present. And so they don't feel the burden of having to make decisions for their patient, for their loved one, because it's been discussed before in their presence. And so there is certainly a growing body of data for early palliative care in advanced cancer. If we go to the next slide, it's also important to just define palliative care versus hospice, because certainly hospice care might incorporate a very small amount of palliative care, but it's certainly the minority of overall care. Palliative care can be offered at any time during disease course, regardless of prognosis. Patients still have access to all of the other treatments, chemotherapy, surgery, radiotherapy, but we do limit most areas, that it, certainly within New South Wales, limit hospice care to when there's been cessation of all disease-directed therapy. So when chemotherapy is stopped, radiotherapy can still be ongoing. You might still do therapeutic interventions and paracentesis and drainages, that sort of thing. But systemic treatments need to have stopped. So the handover of care has been from the oncologist, or the nephrologist, or the cardiologist into the palliative care physician as the driver within hospitals. If we go to the next slide. So if we look at primary versus specialist care, we're certainly, palliative care is not involved with all deaths. It's again probably involved in, I actually don't know the percentage, I think Linda has some slides on that, but we most certainly in the community and in nursing homes, a large majority of palliative care is actually managed by is managed by primary health clinicians, and within hospitals the treating specialty team will be, for most cases of end-of-life care, will be responsible for the management as well. But specialist palliative care really comes in when there is advanced symptom management that is becomes difficult or needs tweaking, needs advice. If there's difficult situations requiring more time and communication skills, and when you need the multidisciplinary team, specialist nursing, allied health, and doctors, whether it be in the community or in the hospital. Next slide, thank you. So within the Sydney Local Health District, the places of care, so first of all, the community, we've got, I'll go give our community borders on the next slide, but we've got close to 200 palliative care patients on the books in the community in Sydney Local Health District. In Concord Hospital, we've got admitting beds into the new Cancer Care Centre, which is very nice, the Rusty Priest Building. Adjacent to that is the Concord Centre for Palliative Care, which is in Concord Hospital. It's still part of it. You still have all the after-hour doctors that come through. It's a 20-bed unit, 16 single rooms and two double rooms. There's the Chris O'Brien Lifehouse, which is not yet, but will be getting its own dedicated palliative care beds, I think within the next year, but it's not entirely sure yet. And at the Canterbury Hospital, which does not have admitting rights for palliative care, but provides a consultation service. In terms of the people, there's doctors, specialised nursing, the case coordinators in the community are the Sydney District Nurses. There's many allied health members, with social workers, occupational therapists, physiotherapists. We have an exercise physiologist within the community, a clinical psychology and Indigenous liaison officer as well. We also, I should have, very remiss of me, bereavement counselling. So we have our bereavement counsellors that also work across the district, and our volunteer service as well, which is actually provides, has been on hold with COVID, but is building up now, provides a lot of support within the palliative care unit, as well as to the community patients as well. If we go to the next slide, this is the borders. In the red is the eastern zone of the Sydney Local Health District, covering from Homebush Roads out to Haberfield, Canterbury, The yellow is the eastern zone from Balmain through to Redfern down to Kingsgrove. And all of these will drain into using the Concord Centre for Palliative Care as the inpatient unit, which is hard because for people who might live towards Kingsgrove, it's actually quite a fair drive. So we do take all of this into account, particularly when we're looking at the preferences of family members and what is best for them overall. The next slide. So this is the Concord Centre for Palliative Care. These are the single rooms. There's a pull-out bed in the side where people are able to stay overnight. It's got the most relaxed COVID visiting rules at the moment in the hospital. There's also a lot of complementary treatments. So there's a massage therapist who comes through every day, music therapy. The volunteers are present. Our animal therapy hasn't come back since COVID, unfortunately, but before COVID, we had a therapy dog and a therapy chicken who wore a nappy, so it wasn't a hygiene issue. But each room opens out to a balcony for fresh air as well. We go to the next slide. Yeah, thank you. So if we look at referral routes, the preferred method at the moment for Concord is through the HealthLink Smart For Me referrals. And this can be through Best Practice, Genie, Medical Direct, and Medical Director. And I'll go through, I'm not sure if this is what is helpful, but I'll go through how to do the referrals on the next slide. But just before then, still on Health Pathways, there is a form that you can print out and fax. And the number is available on Health Pathways as well. And I would like to emphasise at any stage, if you're not sure of how to refer or if it's appropriate to refer, all of the clinicians who are on call would be very happy to discuss through Switch at any stage. So we'd be very happy to receive direct phone calls through the Concord Switch to discuss what is best. And with urgent referrals, it's definitely best to call through. And it happens not infrequently. People who have been at home with dementia for a long time, cared for by their family, might develop a urinary tract infection and become very acutely unwell within the day, and the family have elected to stay at home. And so with those referrals where we really, we triage as an A, we need to get in either that day or the next day. Just because we don't want something being lost on the fax machine or not picked up or accidentally lost in paperwork, we really appreciate a phone call just to make sure that we know that we need to get out there. And we do make sure that we prioritise with nursing. We escalate to make sure that those patients are seen in a timely fashion. On the next slide, so this is the e-referrals. And again, the link is on Health Pathways. If we go through, if you click to make the referral on the Sydney Local Health District Services, and then on the next slide, you click palliative care, then which hospital you want, whether it's a Concord Hospital or whether it's the Royal Prince Alfred. And then on the next slide, it just comes up with who to refer to. I guess is another painful point, but to do with billing in hospital, if there is a clinician who you know it's going to go to, then it's best to choose the clinician. But if it's a completely new referral and you don't know, you can just select any preference. That's completely fine. It does ask you to triage whether the patient is ambulant and can come to clinic or not. We obviously have more spots to see people in outpatient clinics than we do in home visits. So I think we can see roughly 30 people in clinics each week. And we can probably see about 10 people a week in home visits. So we've got much more capacity for clinic visits versus home visits. So we try to reserve those for people who really are not ambulant or deteriorating the home oxygen, that sort of thing, where it really is just too difficult to get out. On the next slide. And so those are just support details with if you've got any issues with sending the e-referrals. On the next slide, the Royal Prince Alfred, they're moving towards e-referrals, but they're not quite there yet. At the moment, they have a generic email, which is listed, which any clinic or home visits will go through to. This is for the medical home reviews. The Sydney Local Health District Community Nursing Support still goes through the chain nursing link, which is on health pathways, but the medical route is this email. I checked for RPA and they haven't actually updated the health pathways for this. So I've sent an email and hopefully that can be done soon. But so home visit or clinic, this is the email address to send through for the Royal Prince Alfred. At the moment, Chris O'Brien, oh, just going back, Chris O'Brien Lifehouse does have an early access clinic, but most of the referrals at the moment are internal, and they have not yet opening up to external referrals. They just haven't, it's still a building service. So I imagine external referrals will be available soon. And at Canterbury, there is no outpatient clinic yet, but again, there are plans to build that up in the next few years. So at the moment, outpatient clinics are Concord and RPA based mostly, unless they're following up from discharge at Chris O'Brien Lifehouse. Next slide, thank you. At the moment, standard care is with clinical support through Sydney Local Health District Nursing. But when people are approaching the deteriorating phase, then we are able to step up with more community supports. And our end-of-life care packages really change no matter in each different area health service. In the Sydney Local Health District, we've transitioned to, and we used to have Silver Chain, and now we've transitioned out of this to the palliative care end-of-life referral in the last 6 months. And this is driven by Sydney District Nursing and the Royal Prince Alfred Virtual Hospital, which extends across the whole district. We call it the PALE package. Part of this has twice daily nursing visits at the polar ends of the day between 8 and 6:30. So usually the usual palliative care nurse or care coordinator will visit in the morning, and then a clinical nurse specialist or clinical nurse consultant will visit in the evening to adjust medications, readjust syringe drivers, or it's mostly a clinical visit at that site to troubleshoot the symptoms through the day. There is also referral to out-of-hospital end-of-life care packages for the non-clinical care, and that can be used for really at the discretion of the family for what's needed. So whether it be a bed wash, a shower, shopping, cleaning, transport, that sort of thing. So it can be utilised for whatever the need of the patient is, and that is usually a daily review. Rapid access to the service is actually pretty available in majority of situations. So within 24 to 48 hours, institution of the package can usually occur. Anything else to say on that? The package is designed to go for about 6 weeks. Prior to termination at 6 weeks, there is a review. Clearly, if there is ongoing clinical need and the patient is really in the final phase of their life, then there is view for extension. If patients look like they're approaching their final phase of their life, and then they stabilize or improve, then there are situations where we discharge people off the packages. It's difficult because patients get a lot of support, and then that some of that care needs to be withdrawn, but we can often keep some of their out-of-hospital non-clinical care going in conjunction with their usual community supports. So there is flexibility, lots of social work involvement and occupational therapy health involvement to help in the transitions as well. And in terms of referral, these are usually driven by the care coordinator, but if you come across someone who you think is appropriate, then call the Sydney District Nursing CNC. I've left the mobile number there, and you can discuss at any stage appropriateness for referral for the end of life care packages, particularly appropriate, as I said, for patients with dementia who need an abrupt step up in care because they've stopped eating, they've stopped drinking, they have an infection, they don't want to go to hospital, or they've had another event that happens at short notice. If we go to the next slide. And just to talk a bit more about the GP can share, which is a new project role, which is fantastic. So we've got a dedicated social worker with us at Concord, Shannon Brown, and she provides early supportive care and intervention for those attending Concord Hospital outpatient clinics. And usually these patients attending outpatient clinics, they're not unwell enough to really need community nursing. They might not have a huge burden of social issues, but so they would normally not get access to social worker involvement, but we've actually found it to be so useful for a myriad of things, financial issues, planning, letters of support, adjustment, the adjustment to illness and the grief that goes with that, huge counselling role that comes with that, grief of not just the person, but their family and partner, significant family dynamics that shift and change as people get into different roles and have to adjust to being in those new roles as well. So we, as part of this, there are joint reviews in clinic that look at holistic intervention, early psychosocial support, preemptive planning, supporting early access to services, supports and emotional adjustment. And she really works as a kind of a spokesperson and communicator between the palliative care team and the general practitioner that is nominated by the patient. The next slide, I guess I just wanted to put a note on prescriptions. There's a lot of patients who require ongoing stable opioid prescriptions. And with these patients, I'm strongly encouraging for monthly, three-monthly review for ongoing medication prescriptions, because patients run out all the time and they forget to make appointments and they call up in a flurry, when they the day after they run out. And I think I think for patients who have got fairly stable but not having ongoing dose titrations, encouragement for these patients to really be booking in monthly or three-monthly for their ongoing prescriptions is fantastic. There's a tendency for patients who go from oncology and they're seeing their doctors every 3 weeks for their blood tests and for their chemo infusions, and then they just get their prescriptions at the time. And then that they might transition out of that into palliative care and they're not needing three-weekly review, they might need six-weekly review, but they haven't set up the practice of making up regular appointments. And they find that adjustment actually really difficult. And so particularly when they start to run out of medications and their pain relief. And so if we can encourage them to book their appointments in, that would be a really helpful thing as well. Sorry, I'm just looking at the Q&A. So Wendy, the difference between the Concord Hospital, the Rusty Priest building is a new cancer care centre. That is, so they've moved out of the old building and we've now moved into, we've now all cancer care services, haematology, oncology, has moved into the Rusty Priest building, which also geriatric services and rehabilitation. So it's just a new wing of the hospital, which is modern and new. And the Concord Centre for Palliative Care is a building that is about 15 metres away from the Rusty Priest building. So it's just a separate, I guess, a separate wing. And patients can be admitted under palliative care in either site. Often it just comes down to bed capacity, preference of the patient, that sort of thing. And do you see any role for medication review when palliative care is considered? Yeah, I think so, absolutely. Whether that be rationalisation of medications, whether it be adjustment of analgesia, Certainly medications get swapped and changed. In order to achieve symptom management, we often need to add in lots of different medications, which is quite cumbersome for patients, and so they're quite keen to see what other ones they can get rid of. And so, yeah, absolutely, medication reconciliation and review is really important.
Dr. Ritchie. Next we have Dr. Linda Sheehan. So Dr. Sheehan is a palliative care physician and a clinical ethics consultant for the Southeast Area Health Service. Dr. Sheehan works as a staff specialist in the consult service at St. George Hospital and is the palliative care stream director at Southeastern Sydney Local Health District.
For the introduction and for having me, it's great to see so many primary health care providers online to talk about palliative care. It's such an important bit of work for us to collaborate on. No worries, thanks so much. I'm really excited to be here because Southeast Sydney Local Health District's been doing a lot of work in strategic planning around palliative care. And one of our key priorities is really trying to map out better ways of engaging with primary healthcare providers in the community services. So I want to talk a little bit about palcare more broadly, as Maggie has done, but in a slightly more focused way in terms of our goals, and then talk you through what we've been doing in our district and how it intersects with your work. And then I'll touch on, I suppose, a couple of the new models of care that we're rolling out, which would hopefully provide better access for general practitioners to get palliative care, multidisciplinary support. So it's timely, I suppose, from that works perspective, as well as just from the discussion and collaboration perspective. So as I said, I'll touch a bit on palliative care from another angle, talk a little bit about the GP's role in palliative care, go through these new models of care that we're going to roll out at CESLED, and then just briefly touch on the palcare referral pathways. I want to start with a quick YouTube video. Some of you may be familiar with this. This is some work that's been coming out of the NHS in the UK by a Professor Brian Nolan, who's actually a nurse who got involved in getting people thinking about time in the context of healthcare, and time being, I suppose, everybody's most important currency in the modern day and age. So I'll start with a video, and then I just want to reflect on it a little bit because it really does frame why what we do in the end of life and palliative care space looks a little bit different than it does when you're 25 and you're in the curative setting. So I'm just going to press play for you.
Day's almost over, the sky is about to show the first glimpse of gold over. Waking up dreams, the thing is I don't know why things that I felt so concerned with just let go. Drift with the breeze. I've been running around looking for answers, and all of these days there still ain't enough. Like the moonlit late plains, that the questions just hang. All I need is time with your love. I've been running around looking for answers, and all of these days there still ain't enough. There ain't enough. Time with you, love. There ain't enough.
So I guess the reason I wanted to play that for you is, I suppose, Professor Nolan really wanted to kind of highlight the fact that we two things. One is that time is the most important currency in the healthcare system, and every day in hospital is a day lost doing the other things that really do matter in life. And I suppose the other piece really to it is, if we waste unnecessary time in clinics or in hospital admissions when a person has limited time, we're, number one, not recognizing they're actually in a hurry because they've got other things that are more important to be doing. But number two, we're not really maximizing the time and quality of that time that they have with the things that they love to do and the people they love to be with. So So I'm having trouble progressing my screen. Just let me try it this way. And so I guess that's what palliative care really is all about. This is the PCA definition. It's really person and family-centered care provided for a person who has active progressive advanced disease with little or no prospect of cure and who is expected to die, where the primary goal is to optimize quality of life. I guess the goal is that people live their life as fully and as comfortably as possible, and we really have a very whole person lens on that. The other important piece is it's very much a family-centered model, meaning that families and carers are also part of that primary locus of care, not just the individual patient, recognizing that care will go through the journey, as Meg has already outlined, from the beginning of end-of-life diagnosis or terminal diagnosis, all the way through death and dying to bereavement. The important thing, I guess, that I always say to people if they say, what do you do as a palliative care physician? I just say my job is to help people live as well as they can until they die. And that has lots and lots of multidisciplinary pieces to it. But it's very much focused on what matters to them and how to maximize the quality of life until that very last day. Obviously, that means it's very patient focused, very much, I guess, calibrated on individual needs. So what each patient will get will depend on who they are and what matters to them. There'll be relief of pain and symptoms, resources such as equipment to aid care at home, assisting families to come together to talk about difficult issues, planning for future medical treatment decisions, and really clarifying goals of care and how treatments might align with that. Linking up to other services such as home help, financial support, support to meet cultural obligations, emotional, social, spiritual concerns, counselling and grief support, and as we said, inter-bereavement, and then I guess access as well to respite care services where required. Just to differentiate that from the terminology around end-of-life care, really in the palliative care space, we talk about end-of-life care really being in that last few weeks of life, where a patient with life-limiting illness is rapidly deteriorating to death. So obviously the needs of the patient and their carers is incredibly high at that time, and the services are built to respond to that change. This phase is recognised as one where we need to give more and do more, and obviously that's a lot more time-consuming and resource-consuming in the community. So part of our goal is to meet the patient where they're at and enable them to have that level of care in a community setting if that's indeed where they want to be. It obviously takes into account that the person is recognised as dying, and then that care extends into bereavement after death occurs. What's the GP's role in palliative care? Obviously, as Megan was saying, most care is in the palliative space or with palliative goals is done by general practitioners, primary healthcare providers in the community. So uncomplicated dying happens all the time. I'm sure many of you do visits to nursing homes and manage death and dying in that context. The only thing I will say is that because of the lack of resources in the community to help assist general practitioners to manage care of their patients in the community till the end of life, it's often very difficult to manage death and dying in a home setting or in the community setting without the support of subspecialist palliative care services in our setting. So while we would love as much involvement of general practitioners in the care of death and dying in community settings as possible, obviously that varies between general practitioners' interest or engagement and also the other services that are available. But from our perspective, we would love general practitioners to be 100% integral to all our patients' death and dying in community settings. Obviously, that's because they are closest to the community in which that person is dying. They're easier to access in subspecialty services. They have incredible rapport and history with their patients and their families. So they're best placed to give that holistic lens to that person with the infrastructure and support from subspecialist palliative care services. I guess there's also a very fundamental role around advanced care planning and future care planning for end of life because of those other relationships. And as I said, what you need really is scaffolding and support from local subspecialist palliative care services where required. I had a little bit of a look to see how often you guys are managing palliative care issues in your day-to-day practice. This data is obviously a little bit old, but this is the most recent we could come up with. I guess 1 in 1,000 GP encounters were palliative care related. 9 out of 10 were people over age 65, but 5% were patients under age 55. Pretty even spread, male to female, but clearly Indigenous Australians are well under-resourced and underrepresented for this type of support in our communities, which is why we're sort of trying to do some work to sort of navigate that inequity. What are the barriers to general practice doing and accessing support in palliative care? I think there's no nationally consistent routine data for reporting around GP provision of palliative care in all domains. I think there's difficulty accessing subspecialty palliative care support for their patients. Certainly in our strategic planning process, the big feedback we got was, when I try to refer, I get rejected for some sort of unknown reason, I'm not really sure when it's appropriate or not. And there's obviously some gaps in how our services are set up and how those services are built to meet general practitioner needs. And I'll speak to that a little bit in our model of care outlines. I think there's a large variation in general practice understanding of what constitutes palliative care and end of life. And that varies between different palliative care settings. So it can get a little bit confusing as to what is the gold standard or best practice in terms of our collaborative management of this cohort of patients. It's also really difficult to keep up-to-date knowledge with all the latest management techniques regarding physical and psychosocial symptom control. This is our subspecialty and you guys are doing a whole lot more than that. And updated guidelines for provision of palliative care is also quite difficult for general practice point of view. I think the other big elephant in the room is that palliative care takes a lot of time. You need to sit and engage with patients. Even in the acute setting, our clinic appointments for a first visit are 1 hour to really get in and under and get that rapport and understand what this all looks like for that individual patient and that family. So obviously the time constraints in general practice make that very difficult to do. So as I said, I think we see a collaborative approach around that as I guess key to the future of sort of supporting each other in managing these patients. As I said, we've been going through this huge strategic planning process, and one of the biggest pieces is actually around community engagement, community support around death literacy, and then how we can better deliver support in the community rather than in subspecialist inpatient units or in the consult setting. We've sort of come up with this huge strategic document, which I won't bore you with, but I guess the most important thing from tonight's perspective is that we're really looking to increase engagement and strengthening the partnerships that we have with other healthcare providers. And it's a no-brainer to say that the primary focus of that has to be general practitioners in the community. There's care collaboration across teams and all that sort of stuff, but to keep people at home doing the things they love with the people they love and not spending their last 1,000 days in clinic appointments or in inpatient settings is absolutely a team effort. And I think we can do better in collaborating on managing that goal with how we restructure services and develop new models of care. I won't go into too much detail about the structures at CESLID. They're complicated, and this is just a quick map to show you how complicated they are. It sounds like many of you are quite familiar with the palliative care services in your service, in your actual districts and areas. So I guess just to quickly flag, there are lots of components to palliative care services. They kind of inreach into various places like aged care, lots of collaboration with the GFS. We've got other sort of third tier partners like Calvary and St. Vincent's involved. It is a complicated space to keep care, clean care coordinated between different spaces. And I can only imagine how that looks for community care providers, just sort of saying, well, unless you're really familiar with what's available in your particular area, it's very hard to know where to start in terms of getting support for your patient that's in the room at that time. I guess to that end, one of the things that we've sort of put into our new strategy is what we're calling community supportive care services. And really, they're sort of being launched at the northern end out of Prince of Wales in the next month. And towards the end of the year, they'll be launched down at the St. George Sutherland end, coming out of St. George, but covering both districts. It's basically a service model that recognises that at the moment what we have is acute consult services in the big house on the hill. Most of those consult services are primarily covering malignancy and cancer patients, although we're gradually getting much better at the non-malignant cohorts like chronic cardiac disease, chronic respiratory disease, chronic liver. But it's still a consult acute setting with follow-up clinics. So very much that old-fashioned tertiary referral model. And then there's sort of this gap until you get to subspecialist community palliative care and palliative care inpatient units. So in the old days, it was 6 months or less, I think, that patients would be accepted by those units and those community services. I think as resourcing has reduced and demand has increased, it's increasingly getting narrower. 6 months or less is still on the board, but really you're looking for those last 3 months of life, patients who are already in the deteriorating phase. So whereas those models were meant to be receptive, say, for patients in the last 12 months of life, really a lot of those services are now very much focused on those very high need, approaching end of life patients that need the whole gamut of palliative care, multidisciplinary input to keep them at home and comfortable for that last phase. So at Cesslin, we are trying to fill that gap, those patients that are not in the acute inpatient setting getting support from the consult service, but are clearly in the last 12 months of their life and approaching the deteriorating phase, but are not yet at end of life, not yet having that rapid trajectory of change that would, I guess, warrant that full multidisciplinary community team that comes out of subspecialist palliative care. So the idea that we've come up with is essentially a multidisciplinary day clinic model, which is supported by a CNC full-time who has subspecialist expertise in palliative care to be the contact person for general practitioners, other community providers and other teams, for example, like HeartLink or RCCP. So that if there are community-based patients who are being managed by other people, so primary care coordination that's not run by palliative care, they can access phone and direct advice from a CNC nurse in palliative care 5 days a week. And that CNC will direct them to the right palliative care service that's appropriate for them. Would that be the palliative care medical clinic, which are already well set up? Would it be this particular community supportive care multidisciplinary clinic, which is come in, see the staff specialist briefly, see a number of the allied health staff for their equipment prescription, social work input, bit of advanced care planning. And then at lunchtime, there's a full case conferencing session with the full multidisciplinary team. And critically to that, we would like to allow the referrers to come into that case conferencing session to hear the outcomes of their assessments and the care plan. And the beauty of that, and Martina may speak to this, is that it's billable for GPs who are interested in engaging in that sort of case conferencing process with their chronic complex care, community multimorbidity, clearly in the last 12 months of life, but not necessarily ready for CBCT. The goals are, you know, pretty clear: improve quality of life for patients approaching end of life in the community, reduce preventable readmissions to acute facilities, and we definitely need your engagement for that, and facilitate appropriate transitions to subspecialist palliative care. So easier way to say, actually, this one's now ready for CPCT or, you know, community services out of Prince of Wales. As I said, the MDT case conferences are billable via the MBS, so it does at least enable GPs who are interested in engaging in that process and hearing firsthand from the palliative care specialists and the multidisciplinary team, this is what we think we need to do for your patient, this is the care plan, this is how we can support you, and that they can kind of carve out time, dedicated time for that consultation and that team approach. And then once we've done our bit, we discharge back to you, but you know how to find us and get back some more support if you need to. So it's a dip in, dip out idea, but it really is just focused on allowing multidisciplinary support in patients who are not yet ready for full takeover of care from palliative care services. There's lots of pieces to it. There's a bit of in-reach associated with it because we want to cover some of the neglected groups like group homes and disability services. But I guess importantly for this audience, the critical component is that the general practitioners and the PHN have an access point that doesn't require them to be fully transferred into the palliative setting or come through emergency and be linked up with the consult setting. Can't give you any phone numbers or email addresses yet. That's all to come. But once those have come through, I will give them to Gloria and send them out to you guys so you know who is that CNC to that you can call in real time with the patient in front of you if you want, or if not, at the end of the day, I don't know what to do with that patient or where to send them, call and get advice and get them triaged into the right multidisciplinary palliative care support to help you do what you do in the community with these patients and families as they approach that very last phase. There's also equipment position and setup available through that. So lots of like subspecialist allied health support can be accessed through that. So if you have someone with communication device difficulties, or you just need a, you know, a walking frame or a wheelchair because their functional status is starting to decline, lots of bereavement, death literacy education stuff is going to come out of these clinics. Lots of community facing engagement as well. So hopefully a bit of a watch this space, but these supportive care clinics will provide a bit of scaffolding for us to start building a way of filling that gap. Trigger for referrals, as I said, we'll send this through when it's finalised, but last 12 to 24 months of life, input from medical and at least one other member of the multidisciplinary team, short-term intermittent subspecialist palliative care input, so as in intervals greater than 4 weeks would probably be the rule of thumb. And as Megan's already flagged, just answer no to the surprise question. That's kind of like your triaging tool in your mind. Is this person appropriate for this clinic? And there's a sort of general trigger document that goes with this, and it really is based very much on the SPIC tool. So there's general triggers for different disease cohorts. Obviously, some of your cohorts will be multi-morbidity, so they're not as aligned. That's why a surprise question is so brilliant. Trust your own acumen. If there's a no to the surprise question, then they're probably appropriate for this multidisciplinary input if you think they need it, or in the context of you understanding their background and their context. I guess there are lots of resources on health pathways. I didn't want to belabor all the stuff that's on there. I think Martina is actually going to speak to it. I know you're all very familiar with it. Our health pathways at CESLIN have been updated very recently. There's a lot of good information, advice, resources on there, as well as all the referral requirements you need for your particular domains across our district. And as I said, these new models of community supportive care services, they're currently being set up and rolled out. And once we've got, here's your person, this is the phone number, these are the clinic days, this is what it looks like with a little package. We'll send it through to Gloria and she can disseminate for you guys to have a look at so you know how to get a hold of us if you want to utilise those services. That's all I had. I would love to hear discussion and questions. So Karen has just stated, although cancer accounts for only about 30 to 35% of death, it accounts for 75 to 85% of PALCA services. Strong bias continues to persist in your protocols and guidelines. Are the PALCARE networks working towards correcting the imbalance, or do they persist in shying away from the unpredictable prognosis? Great question. No, we do not persist in shying away from the uncertain prognosis of non-malignant disease. Look, it's clearly a huge issue. The inaccuracy of diagnosis, or I guess the less predictability of diagnosis and the longer trajectories, makes it a lot harder for us to contain, I suppose, the referral process. And I know that's what you're referring to when you say shying away. I think the renal supportive care journey has showed everybody and gathered the evidence required that palliative care in a supportive care method in all chronic disease subspecialties has a role, not only improving quality of care and patient quality of life, but in ensuring appropriate transitions to palliative approaches and changes in goals of care when required. So as part of these community supportive care services, we talked about the multidisciplinary clinic, which you guys can utilise, but the other arms to that are embedded care services being set up from palliative care at each of these sites in cardiac and respiratory as a first port of call to try and emulate what's been achieved in renal supportive care and really start gathering some proper data about those cohorts, better do the symptom management and quality, but also hopefully keep those people in the community and support the subspecialist teams in the community that are linked to those cohorts to move to end-of-life care in a more timely way and transition them to palliative care when appropriate. So we recognise that's the next frontier and we've already started. The other big area, I think, is chronic liver disease. It's a bit trickier because the headspace of that subspecialty cohort from a medical perspective is a little bit further behind than the others. But we're running a pilot at St George at the moment, doing supportive care in the liver space. And we've already got pilots that have been successful in respiratory and cardiac. So that's the rollout first up. But there are a multitude of cabs off the rank that need to be executed. So this is just the beginning. I think actually in our service at St George, we have a much closer to 50-50 input from a consult setting in terms of specialist palliative care support for different disease specialties. Some of that support is specialist nursing only support. Some of it is medical. There still is a skew to subspecialist medical in the cancer space versus in the other spaces. And part of these supportive care service models is to try and correct that. So everybody in palliative care is talking about this. We all know that this is a huge cohort of patients that are missing out so far. We've grown up under cancer. Many of us still live under cancer in our acute infrastructure and incest lib. That's still the case. They're sort of part of the reason for this strategic planning work is to scoop us out under cancer and look at end of life more broadly and create a strategy that really is aimed at doing exactly that, not just focusing on cancer, but bringing us out from our happy place or our comfortable place and really broadening the lens. So these community supportive care clinics are specifically targeting, it's not aged care, and there's a lot of reasons for that. That's related to the Ministry of Health KPIs and funding, and obviously aged care has a whole lot of other buckets that they can access to support aged care. But the other cohorts, like not just MND, but other neuromuscular disorders or neurodegenerative disorders for patients under 60 years of age, cardiac and respiratory, liver, all of this non-malignant cohort are really the target area for this. And some of the orphan stuff, like, you know, end stage, you know, anorexia nervosa that are taking a palliative approach and they need a dietitian and they need this and they still need psychosocial support, but no one actually owns them in the system. The target audience is non-malignant community-based care who are primarily coordinated either by yourselves or by other teams like cardiac, respiratory, liver, etc. Maria's question was around end-of-life care plans. How will we be informed of the planning meeting? How long in advance? If we're able to attend, will we get a copy of the plan? If you're talking about the case conferencing outcome, the notice you'll get will be when you ring and say, I would like my patient to come to the clinic, or you make the referral, the CNC coordinator will make the appointment and let you know when it is. And that will include the time for the case conferencing discussion. So if you're interested in being involved in the case conferencing and billing for that, you can block that out in your calendar and dial in at the dedicated time to talk about your patient with a palliative care specialist and the multidisciplinary team. In terms of advanced care planning, which is a different thing, that sort of will be discussed as part of the broader case conferencing if it's happened in the context of the clinic, with either, you know, the medical, social work or nursing staff. But I suppose all of that should be captured in the case conferencing opportunity. Now, obviously, some GPs won't have time or it's not particularly their focus to be involved in that team-based discussion. They would absolutely get a full copy of the reports from all the disciplines that saw their patient. And I guess our goal is for that to come back to the referral within 72 hours. Obviously, we'll see how that plays out in real time. But the goal is to ensure the communication from all the disciplines that saw that patient and the case conference report goes back in a timely fashion. There's another question. Can you comment on the practice I've seen of trying to discharge end-of-life patients from a palliative care ward when the patient obviously only has days to live because of pressure on beds? I'm not sure where that question's coming from. It may well have come in the context of COVID. Obviously, there's been a lot of rapid discharges in the context of COVID for and a massive increase in home deaths, actually, even in non-COVID cohorts, because of the visitor restrictions and all the constraints that were introduced into the inpatient units. And patients didn't want to be alone or not with their loved ones or not embedded in their families. So there was a lot of frantic late discharging happening over the last 2 years from inpatient units all over the state, mainly related to the public health measures that were being instituted into IPUs, which is, you know, a really huge impact because of all the, you know, embeddedness required to really look after someone in a relational way as they die. To be honest, I have never seen a palliative care patient discharged from a palliative care inpatient unit when they were dying against their wish because of bed pressure. I mean, that is just not how palliative care works, which is one of the wonderful things about palliative care over acute medicine. Obviously, there's always pressure on beds. That is very palpable in the acute setting. I see lots of hasty and untimely discharges from the acute hospitals, but subspecialist inpatient units who have palliative care patients in their beds with very clear focus on end of life would generally, to my experience, only discharge a patient who really wanted to get home for end of life. And we like pull out all stops to try and make that happen. So I take more comment on that or more context to it. But one of the great things about working in palliative care is patients come first. And, you know, if we have to refurbish the clinic room to keep them in the hospital, that is what we do. Any other questions? Karen, thanks for that affirmation of change. Powercare report last decade also showed that 40 to 50% of GPs don't realise that powercare is for non-cancer illness too, so we need that awareness raised amongst us. Absolutely. I think we've done a lot of cancer for a long time. We're very good at cancer. We're very comfortable with it. It's been a great win for malignancy because obviously cancer is very complicated, particularly from a symptom perspective at end of life, whereas some of the other diseases from a medical palliative care perspective are potentially not as complicated from a symptom control perspective, but remembering palliative care is full multidisciplinary whole person care. So there's a whole lot of other stuff that can contribute to the care of those cohorts, advanced care planning discussions, you know, future goals of care discussions, planning, you know, there's all the multidisciplinary allied health support that comes with a full multidisciplinary service is critical for patients who are facing end of life, regardless of their, I guess, primary disease. So just know we will take referrals from malignant and non-malignant patients. We recognize that we've been stuck under cancer. We're trying to get out from under cancer. We're here to help you if your patient's in your last 12 months of life and you think you need subspecialist palliative care input from a medical perspective and or multidisciplinary input, please refer them to our new community supportive care clinics for some help. And we will then also help flag when it's appropriate for their transition to a more fulsome community palliative care service from Calvary or St. Vincent's, Prince of Wales, depending on where you're at. There's no other questions in the chat.
Thanks, Dr. Sheehan. That was really informative.
Thanks.
And then our final speaker for tonight is Dr. Martina Gleeson. Dr. Gleeson is a local GP working out of Caringba Family Practice. Dr. Gleeson is also the lead GP and clinical editor for Southeastern Sydney Health Pathways and is the regional clinical advisor for Health Pathways in New South Wales.
Hi, everybody. And can I first say thank you to Linda and Megan. It's really exciting to see this new strategy developing, and I look forward to reflecting that on our health pathways. Just going to share my screen. For those of you who maybe are not familiar with health pathways, I've got... takes a while, doesn't it? There we go. There's the login details. Well, the QR code to the health pathways. If you don't have a login detail to either of the health pathways, please contact our team. If you have a login to one of the pathways and you would like to have a look at the other set of pathways, you can use the same username and password to access both, both pathways. And certainly for GPs who live on the border of the Sydney Local Health District and the Southeastern Sydney Local Health District, it's helpful to be able to look at both, especially for the referral information. Just a little tip, this is a new thing that we've put into our education. If you're looking for something specific and you want to do a search, we're using COVID just as an example here, but you can type in a word search to the top of the search bar, or if you're viewing health pathways on the classic view, it'll be in the column on the left-hand side. You'll see a search bar. This example uses sotrovimab. So you type in that at the top and it will tell you which pathways you're going to find that word. And then if you click on the expand all button when you get to the pathway and then use control F, which is a word find function, type in the word you're looking for and all the results where that word is listed will be shown. That you can use that on all health pathways to find a specific thing that you might be looking for. This is a brief run through of the sorts of palliative care pathways you'll find on your local team. So Southeastern Sydney has got, we worked very hard with Linda and some of the team from St Vincent's as well to develop some palliative care pathways in the first year of the pandemic. And so all of these pathways can be accessed. Symptom management is definitely not just related to cancer. Caring for a dying patient at home is definitely not just related to cancer. The differences between at home and in an RACF, for example, how to manage life, last days of life. And I'm going to show you the palliative care requests in a minute. Sydney has very similar pathways. Management of the terminal phase, new palliative care patients, symptom control in palliative care, again, not all focused on pain management and on cancer. Just before I go to the live demonstration, I just want to let you know that we are looking for GPs to nominate themselves as GPs with special interest who are happy to see other GPs patients in consultation for some advanced skills. And these are some of the particular areas that we're interested in. And if you would like to nominate yourself to be listed on our GP colleague referral pathway, if you could contact Sue Baker on that slide and ask for your practice to be listed or for yourself to be listed, we'd be very happy to facilitate that. We also, both Sydney and Southeastern Sydney, have feedback and reviews processes, and our pathways are reviewed every 3 years. So it's a good time for you to provide any thoughts on the content and usability of the pathways. We've currently got diabetes, cardiology, rheumatology, infectious diseases, and aged care under review. So if you're looking at one of those pathways and you can see that it needs updating or that you have some suggestions, then please use the feedback button, which is this little blue icon at the bottom of each pathway, to send us some feedback. And there are the contact details for both of the pathway teams. Now, I'm just going to stop sharing for a minute so that I can go back and choose my live demonstration page. So now you should be able to see the Sydney Health Pathway site, and I'm just highlighting on the left here the pathways that they have. Whenever you see a cross in a health pathway, that means if you can open it up and you can get a whole lot more pathways. But because today has been focusing on how to access palliative care advice or input from the specialists, I'm focusing on showing you that Sydney has a pathway on urgent palliative care assessment or admission, palliative care assessment, and palliative care advice. And Linda mentioned case conferences, so I also wanted to point out that there's a health pathway for that. If you're not quite sure how to organise a case conference or how to participate in a case conference, what's involved, you can refer to that pathway in Sydney. Southeastern Sydney also has a similar section on palliative care requests, as well as a lot of those symptom management pathways. And I just wanted to point out that in the palliative care advice pathway, we do have the renal, Here we are. So that's in the specialist palliative care assessment. You can also, you've got the contact details for the renal supportive care, for palliative care people, and you've also got it because St. Vincent's also has a non-malignant palliative care outpatients clinic. So you've got lots of options there. And we also have the case conference pathway that Linda mentioned, because wouldn't it be great if we were all participating in case conferences a little bit more? With telehealth, there's no restriction. You don't have to be at the case conference in person. So you can participate in case conferences using telehealth. And the other thing to know is that there are also allied health item numbers for case conferences. So that can be a very helpful thing to know, because previously allied health practitioners didn't have an item number for their participation in case conferences, so it would have been harder to organise them. But now that they have an item number, as they should, it's easier to organise a case conference with them.
I'd like to take a moment to thank all of our speakers. I think tonight was really informative, and I hope everyone got some value out of it.
Just to sort of flag, and I know Megan said this in her talk as well, we're actually on call 24/7. So if you're stuck and you just want to get a hold of a palliative physician and get some advice, you can do that. And I know Martina's flagged that it's in health pathways how to do that. But if it's a Saturday afternoon and you're getting a call and you're not sure what to do, we often field calls from the community, from general practice. So please feel free to reach out for just some phone advice from palliative specialist that's on. We all have 24/7 services, and we're very happy to take calls from GPs. So just to make sure you know, even with all the new services and all that sort of stuff, that's all very well, but also we are already available to you if you need help for your particular patient in a timely way or an emergent way. Just ring us. We're very happy to speak to you.
Bye-bye.
Thanks. Bye.